I'm here with Professor Laurence Baker from Stanford Medical School, and I'm hoping he can at least start to get me to understand something that I've always wondered about and worried about a little bit. Let's say that I'm some drug company. So let me write this down. So like I'm some pharma company A right over here. And let's say that I invest 10 years and $100 million in some drug. I get it through all of the clinical trials, and it gets approved by the FDA. And let's say, just for sake of simplicity, it cures disease X. Now, once I get to that point, I'm feeling pretty good about myself. I'm as the pharma company. What happens next? I mean, I'm assuming that I'm going to have to go to the insurance companies and maybe Medicaid and Medicare and figure out how much they're going to pay for it. But how does that conversation even happen?
Yeah, so you're going to have a conversation with a bunch of different folks. So in the U.S., we have lots of different private insurance plans. We got government plans. And you're actually going to have conversations with Europe and with some of the other systems around the world, because each system is going to make its own
decision. And they have a different way of doing it.
They may not. They have some similarities in the way that they probably want to talk to you about it.
Does there tend to be a lead system? Does it tend to be either the Europeans, or does it tend to be the private insurers in the U.S., or do you start all of those conversations at once because there's so much money on the table?
So there will be some strategy your business is going to come to, because it's very hard to have all these conversations exactly simultaneously.
Right.
So you'll talk to the U.S., you talk to Europe. And there are some cases in which people have viewed the regulatory processes in Europe as a little easier for some things, so they may want to start in Europe. But in other cases, if you're looking at a drug that maybe some of the national systems in Europe are less likely to want to pay for, you might start with the U.S., where there's a little more flexibility.
But the general rule of thumb is all of the money is in Europe and the U.S. mainly right now.
A lot of it's there. The Asian systems, and some of them are pretty sophisticated and using a lot of the advanced drugs too. But I think the majority of the money's in U.S. and Europe.
Right. And between Europe and the U.S., I guess I've always imagined it was a lot. North America was maybe where the bulk of the money was. But is that the case?
The U.S., our healthcare system spends more than everybody in the world, and it's true for drugs too. We spend more on drugs here than most other places.
So definitely, if I'm here, pharma company A, I mean, I want to make sure I get this right in the U.S.
Yeah, eventually you probably care a lot about
that. Part of my investment that I've made is based on some understanding that if I got all the way through, that I would get some type of return within the U.S. So let's say will I immediately go to Medicare because they're one of the largest players, or will I go to, like we talked about, Blue Cross, Blue Shield, or Kaiser, or some of these other players?
Medicare is actually kind of an interesting one for drug prices, because historically Medicare has not been a big coverer, and still isn't, of a lot of the drugs that you hear about. So Medicare does not pay by itself for outpatient drugs that you might take at home.
Really? No, Medicare, I always assumed that they don't. They don't.
So Medicare, in its main pieces, Medicare we call Part A, Part B, Part C. So Part A and Part B, let's go start there. They tend not to cover, or they don't cover, outpatient drugs. If you get a drug in the hospital while you're hospitalized, Medicare will pay for those. And so if you got a drug that's going to be primarily used in that setting, you're going to talk to Medicare about it, and that's going to be an important piece of the conversation. But if you're talking about an outpatient drug, you're talking to many.
And when we say outpatient, I mean inpatient is you're in the hospital, you're sick, you need, I don't know, morphine right now. That's inpatient drug.
Yeah.
Outpatient is, hey, you're going back home, take this three times a day.
Yeah, somebody sends you to the pharmacy to pick up the prescription and you take it home with you. That's going to be an outpatient kind of drug. So Medicare doesn't cover that in its main Part A and Part B. There's Medicare Part D, which is a drug plan in Medicare. And that will cover a lot of the outpatient drugs. And so there you have conversations with them. But most of the Medicare Part D plans are essentially private companies that Medicare contracts with. So you're not really talking to the government at that point. You're talking to these private plans that have contracted with Medicare to be Part D carriers.
So once again, going back to the crux of the question of how are these drugs going to get paid for, how are we going to determine the price at which these drugs get paid for, it goes back to the private plans again.
Because
they're going to contract. Part D is going to say, oh, you're Medicare Part D, we're going to go to Aetna, we're going to go to somebody. Other plan, or whoever it might be. I don't know
whoever's offering those
Part D plans. And so it'll kind of ride off of whatever that private party has already negotiated with the pharma company.
It'd be related probably.
Okay, so let's say we have some type of insurance. Let's call this insurance. I'm running out of letters now. Let's call this insurance company Y right over here. Mm-hmm. And I go have a conversation with insurance company Y, and I was like, hey, this is a big deal, you know, disease X, you know, it's been killing people. I want $1 million per pill.
Yeah, and so those have been really interesting conversations in the U.S. So there's some bargaining back and forth between the insurance company and the drug maker. The drug maker is going to have spent a lot of money. You've got $100 million up there.
Yes.
In most cases, the
I deserve to make at least $10 billion off of it.
So there's a certain amount, a certain extent.
It's called anchoring in a negotiation.
Right. Anchor. Right. You start with what you think you can get.
Yes,
you
yes.
Put out a number to get everybody's mind around it. Right. Yeah. So, you know, in reality, it costs well over $100 million to take a drug through the trials, to do the development work and stuff. So they're going to be sitting there with a number, at least internally, saying, we want to get our $800 million, our $1.5 billion back from this. And so we're going to try
Because it's not just the cost of that one drug. Is that you, so what is the cost? Do you know that off the top of the room?
Oh, it's hundreds of millions. Just so there's the development costs that go in that the pharma companies aren't typically willing to talk a lot about.
Right.
And then there's the cost of getting through the trials and the FDA approvals, which people say, you know, $500 million and up. They'll say higher numbers sometimes.
For one given drug.
Yeah.
$500 million. So it can be as high as $500 million.
It can be higher.
Can be greater than $500 million. And so that doesn't even take into kind of the probability weighted risk that there's a 10% chance that it fails or a 10% chance that it works.
Right.
So it's really if you're spending $100 million per drug and only one out of 10 of those drugs are going to get to the end zone.
Yeah, you'll see along the way. You're actually spending. Spend the whole wad and then find out. You'll find out in steps.
I see,
you'll have to spend something to get there.
So even though this on one drug it might be $100 million or $500 million, they might have spent another $300 or $400 million on drugs that didn't go anywhere.
Plus their own development costs in the background.
Plus their own development costs. So if you try to kind of fully load the costs, it's a large number.
It's a large number. So they're running They're running an operation where they've got to put a lot of money in up front. When they get a success, they have to get enough out of that one success to pay for the operation to kind of keep things going for the next development round. So they're looking at those kinds of numbers, and they're trying to figure out in this negotiation what they can sell this for, and that's a back-and-forth discussion. The insurance companies have some ability to say what they're willing to pay, but a lot of these drugs, if they're doing a cure in a disease that people care about, the pharma companies have a lot of ability to come and say, this is what we need to get for this and set that price and be able to get it for a while.
So who has, I mean, obviously the pharma company is coming here with all of this investment. They definitely want it to get covered. But the insurance company, I guess their incentive is they don't want to look like all of a sudden this company that doesn't provide the cure for disease X. I mean, do insurance companies ever walk away and say, well, you know, that's just too much. I understand you invested all this money, but we just can't do that. That's just crazy.
So the U.S., it's a little bit of a mixed bag. The U.S. doesn't have a lot of cases where insurance companies have really put their foot down and said, no, they're not going to do anything.
Yeah.
They're not going to have anything to do with some new drug that comes out. And some of that's due to the existence of lots of different companies. So, you know, if five of the companies say no, but the next guy in line says yes, then the dynamic of that in a competitive market is often that everybody else will eventually come around and say, okay, you know,
someone's going to do something. They might not pay for it outright. But that's why I guess the whole reason why we're having this conversation is because there are some drugs that are, seem like reasonably priced to me, but there's some that are like $30,000 a pill or something. I made up that number, but.
Yeah, so the cases, the really expensive ones are drugs that are unique, tend to be unique at least to some extent, cure a disease that gets some high profile, so people are worried that they're going to die if they don't get this drug. And of course, they're still on patent. That's another feature of all this. You get the high price for a certain period of time until your patents run out.
And then the generic.
And then generic comes in. And the price.
The cost of the pill, which is.
Which drops
pennies or dollars. Right.
So, how you get these things set in a competitive market is an interesting question. One of the things that happens. One of the things that gets the brand name drugs to be a little cheaper is competition within the class. So if there's two or three drug manufacturers who have something that'll basically do the same thing, that'll tend to take the edge off the $30,000 a pill kind of situation and get you down reasonable, more reasonable prices. It won't get you all the way to generic pricing.
But it just seems to me, you just mentioned that very few insurance companies have ever walked away from this. If you ever have a negotiation, buying a used car, whatever, where one of the two parties is not walking away, then it doesn't seem like there's actually a serious negotiation. I mean, am I getting that wrong, or is...
Yeah, so I don't know all the ins and outs of all these
negotiations. Right.
There's lots that goes on in these things, but I think that one of the things that people would say about the U.S. is that when a drug manufacturer comes up with a fairly unique on patent drug that does some tangible good, that they more or less can set the price that they want to get for it, and they're going to make some calculation because they could set a high enough price that everybody would say forget it, so they're going to try and figure out something, but they're trying to get as much as they can, and they get some leeway for at least a period of time to
name. So they'll get leeway, and I guess there's some range of reasonableness where it's like, okay, yes, you've done something amazing for humanity. You're going to get a 35% return on your investment, but that shouldn't be a 300% return on your investment.
Yeah, I don't know at what point the U.S. would ever walk, or the private insurers
would ever
walk from this. I haven't seen it really happen, and I think drug companies are pretty sophisticated about trying to figure out what price they think they can make work and get that as high as they can get that.
Yeah, so I guess I'm still back where it's still unclear to see who's kind of making out here really well.
You know, this has been a really interesting debate. You know, pharma companies put huge amounts of money into these drugs, and once in a while they do some really useful things and they get high premiums. There are other people who argue that some of the things that they're getting high premiums for, you know, aren't really valuable enough, or somehow we've been told we need a drug that if we had it to our own devices, we would never come up with the fact that we need it. And so, you know, what's the real value at the end of the day? And I think that's one of the debates we're going to have in this country for a little while. The industry's been coming up with new things, and they're going to keep trying to do
right.
that. We want to, from a social standpoint, from a policy standpoint, try to make sure that things we're doing are really valuable to society and not copies of other drugs, or not inventing a disease that didn't need a solution and then solving the problem. And sometimes
right.
we worry that maybe we're getting some of that. And I think that's the challenge for the U.S. health insurance system, for the regulatory process, is to try to guide the innovation and guide the purchasing of these things to really create the most value for society. It's been a challenge. It's going to be a challenge. We have the challenge because we have tremendous opportunity.
Yeah. So your gut sense, there probably are some drugs out there that maybe we are, that they're doing really well, maybe well above and beyond the investment cost, but it's hard to say. It's really on a case-by-case basis.
Yeah, I don't think you'd want to make a generic
statement
about all the drugs that have been discovered. Some of the things that we've put out there in the last couple decades are really important drugs that are going to do a lot of good. And, you know, I think there are debates about some other ones where maybe somebody's been able to be clever about marketing and sell it, and we're less sure that it's
And that,
really
that actually marketing, not to make this conversation too long, but you know, some people bring up that the drug companies, you know, they say, look, there's a lot of investment right over here on this, and so they have to get some reasonable return on it, and that seems to make sense, especially when you probability weight it and all of that.
Yeah.
But they spend a significant amount on marketing as well, on actual marketing. You watch the nightly news, most of the ads you're going to see drug companies, they do the physician dinners, and they do all their things like that. I mean, that seems to undermine that argument that all of the money is going for R&D.
Right. If you just towed up the dollars, I'm not sure how you'd actually, what the numbers would come out like. And it's, you know, honestly, the pharma companies aren't really excited about telling everybody all the details of their businesses for good reason.
Right.
So I'm not sure, but it's absolutely, there's a huge amount of marketing.
You spend a ton of money on the marketing, and then you get the consumer here to kind of put the pressure on the insurance companies and the doctors to say, hey, you better cover that, or I'm asking for that, whatever it might.
Right. Yeah, there was a time, you know, within my memory, where we weren't allowed to do direct-to-consumer marketing, where the laws prohibited that, and the change came around, and now we're allowed to do it, and it's really changed the way that drugs are marketed.
I mean, I have found that weird, because if these are drugs that are meant to be by prescription, and it should, so it's, which means that it should be a doctor's judgment on whether or not you should get the drugs, why is it being advertised on the nightly news to a general audience?
Right, a general audience who doesn't understand all the ins and outs of the drug, and whose doctor may or may not want to take the time to explain it.
But then they'll go to the doctor and say, please give me this drug, and then the doctor, it's easier for them to say, well, sure.
Yeah, no, I think a lot of doctors would express a certain amount of frustration about that. Their patients come in, it's hard to have the conversation in a short period of time, so it's easier just to give them the drug.
Fascinating.